This is coal, and it's a fossil fuel. Gasoline, that's a fossil fuel. And plastic, well, that's a fossil fuel too. That's how we have to think about plastic, because plastic is made of oil. And of all the uses of oil, plastic is growing the fastest. But we don't often think about plastic as a part of the climate crisis. And the simple fact is, for the climate, for our ocean, and for our health, we have to use less gas, less oil, and less coal everywhere. And that means for energy, for cars, and for plastic, too. Because 11 million tons of plastic is going into our ocean every year. 11 million. And if we do nothing, in 2 decades, that's going to triple. And we can think about that a little bit like a massive oil spill. It's killing seabirds from the outside in and from the inside out. And just like Exxon is synonymous with the Exxon Valdez oil spill, today, it's the largest manufacturer of single-use plastic in the world. Just to give you a sense of scale, the oil used to make those 11 million tons of plastic is about the same as 800 Exxon Valdez oil spills every year. And it's not just the lives of seabirds that we're sacrificing for that plastic. It's a family that lives by a fracking site. It's communities along the Gulf of Mexico, mostly black and brown communities, whose neighborhoods have turned into cancer clusters because of the plastic production facilities in their backyards. And those plastic production facilities have now replaced coal-fired power plants as the biggest new sources of greenhouse gas pollution that's warming our planet. And we are all going to suffer the consequences of that. We can't solve the climate crisis if we have to keep drilling more and more oil to make plastic. And to understand what to do about that, I think it's useful first to talk about how this plastic crisis exploded in the first place. Because here's the thing, more than half the plastic ever made was made in just the last 20 years. 20 years. Why? Because just when we thought we were running out of oil, this was the early 2000s, anyone remember that? Oil companies won the lottery. They discovered fracking. And suddenly, they had more oil and more gas than they knew what to do with. And at the same time, they were losing markets for their products, right? The writing was on the wall. There were electric vehicles, renewable energy, energy efficiency. So they began to bet heavily on a new market, plastics. And if they continue at the current pace, by 2050, we will use more oil per person to make plastic than we will to fuel our cars. That's a crisis for the ocean. It's a crisis for the climate. And it's a crisis for the people who live near where it's made or where it ends up. But here's the thing. In order for the plastics industry's bet to pan out, they need us. They need us to believe that that growth is inevitable. They'll tell us, if we want a better life, we need more plastic. They'll tell us, the problem isn't how much we're using, it's how much we're throwing away, right? They've been telling us since the 50s, if we just stopped littering, it wouldn't be ending up in the ocean. They're telling us, oh, the problem isn't the companies making the plastic, it's the people who are using the plastic. Because they need us to believe it's our fault for not recycling better, for not cleaning up after ourselves. They need us to feel ashamed. And it's working. Let me tell you, when people find out that I work on plastics, the first response is shame. They'll do really strange things, right? They'll hide away their plastic water bottle. Sometimes, you know, they tell me they won't let me go in the office kitchen, right? Because they've got plastic utensils in there. Sometimes they start confessing how much they recycle at home. But less than 10% of plastic is actually recycled because it's not designed to be. And even if we recycled as much plastic as possible, we'd only solve part of the problem because we'd still need oil and an awful lot of energy to make it, and we'd still be left with a lot of plastic getting dumped or burned when we're done. If we want to solve this crisis, the most important thing we have to do, there's just one, we have to produce less plastic. Now, that's a big shift. But let me give you an example from the automotive industry that helps me wrap my head around the idea that that kind of systems change is actually possible. So, when my parents first moved here from India, they used to have this white Ford Fairmont. And my dad loves to tell us, you know, it got 16 miles to a gallon, but only if you didn't turn the AC on. And as you can see, this was the 80s, early 80s. For the next 20 years, car companies sold us bigger, more gas-guzzling cars. And the average fuel efficiency of the U.S. car and truck fleet basically stayed flat for 20 years. And they said consumers didn't want it. It'd be too expensive, too unsafe. Electric vehicles could never work, and even if they did, we would never have the charging infrastructure. And then, California passed a law to fight climate change, and they required radically more fuel-efficient vehicles. And then we did it nationally. And our policymakers took a stand against what the auto companies said was possible or not. We stopped asking for marginally more fuel-efficient vehicles, and we started dreaming of cars on a clean electric grid that didn't need oil. That's systems change. And it didn't happen by accident. It happened because of a lot of gutsy policy and innovation and big bets, and we knew it was possible long before it actually happened. And it's not just about replacing every car with an electric vehicle. It's the idea that when we're fighting for a different reality, a reality where cars don't need oil, a whole other landscape of possibilities come into view, right? It's about the car in your driveway that can store the power from your rooftop and keep the lights on during a storm. It's e-bikes and scooters in cities that can help make our transit systems more effective. It's about learning to actually recycle those batteries so we aren't stuck in the same cycle of mining. Systems change. That's what we have to create for plastic, but we have to start by dreaming of a system with radically less plastic. And we need policy to make it more than just a PR campaign, more than that plastics-free lifestyle you can have if you can afford to shop at Whole Foods, right? That means policy that reduces the overproduction of plastic from the start, especially that plastic that's only used once, has harmful chemicals, and always ends up on our beaches. We need policy that makes companies pay for the pollution they're making, from where it's made to where it ends up. And we have to stop giving tax breaks to oil companies that are just pumping out cheap plastics. Can't give them tax breaks because we need that money to fund innovation. Innovation that's going to help us accelerate this transition, right? It's a big job, but I'm hopeful, and I'll tell you why. Over 120 countries from India, Canada, Chile, Rwanda have all banned some single-use plastics. California just passed a sweeping plastics bill. They just tried to do something similar here in Oregon. That plastics bill reduces single-use plastics, and Ocean Conservancy estimates that over 10 years, it's about the same as taking 25 million cars off the road. That's huge. In Europe, the plastics policy is making McDonald's test reusable dishes in their restaurants in France and Germany. And we just started negotiating a global treaty to end plastic pollution. And on the climate side, I'll tell you, I feel hopeful for maybe the first time in my career, because the US just passed a sweeping package of climate incentives, $350 billion. To get us off of oil, gas, and coal. But there's a catch. That historic legislation didn't include plastic, because we don't see plastic as a climate problem. And we can't get to that clean energy future unless we stop drilling oil to make plastic. If we want a future where big oil doesn't turn into big plastic, we have to make and use less. And in the US, that would be a pretty big change from the system that's been put upon us, right? We produce 3 to 5 times as much waste as the average person in Japan or India or Egypt. I also take that in as an example that there's so much stuff that's already working, stuff that we can build on, right? As I mentioned, I am a child of immigrants, and one of the great things about that is that you have all these lived experiences of how people do things differently. You see how culture kind of adapts to what's available in a place. And something that I always touch back to is my grandfather's 80th birthday in Kerala at my uncle's house. And I remember how surprised I was as this kid who had grown up in the States to see that a house full of 30 people used maybe 2 or 3 handfuls of waste at every meal. Can you imagine? We ate on banana leaves with our hands, and we drank out of metal cups. We had boiled water, so we didn't have bottles. And we drank soda out of refillable glass bottles. And I don't say this because I think we need to rewind the clock. I say it because that wasn't 50 years ago. That was the year 2000. And more than half the plastic ever made was made since then. Remember that. Because we can pretty much guarantee that the plastics industry is going to tell us we can't change the way we've always lived. They're going to tell us systems change is impossible because consumers won't accept it. They're going to tell us focus on the waste and forget where it came from. Because they need us to forget that we can choose a different future than the one they're selling. So here's my challenge for us. We have to listen for those lies and remember where they came from. They're a desperate attempt of an oil and gas industry in decline. Our challenge isn't the absence of solutions. It's an absence of imagination on how to make money on the proven tools we already have to reduce plastics. Right? Imagine if we actually designed plastics to be recycled with far fewer chemical additives. Couldn't that supercharge our recycling systems? What if we used this move for online shopping to actually get rid of all of that flashy packaging? Because it's just getting thrown away, right? And while we're at it, let's design those products to last 2 or 3 times as long. How about if we designed reuse and refill systems, but at the scale of a whole city, not just one store or one brand? Right? Couldn't that make them affordable and more effective? And what if we stopped being ashamed and trusted our ability to adapt and change and demanded real choices from companies and policymakers? I know that sounds big, but renewable energy sounded too big once. Electric cars sounded too big once. We can do big things because we don't have to be trapped in this world where drilling oil for plastic is a given. Climate action can't end at cars and power plants. Because just like this coal is a fossil fuel, and gasoline is a fossil fuel, plastic is a fossil fuel too.